last year. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and members of the delegation. First, I want to thank the members of the delegation for making time for today's meeting. This is obviously a local delegation meeting, not one that's planned for by the House, with the House calendar. It's an extra meeting, if you will. So it's a sacrifice on the part of the members to get together like this, and I really appreciate them all coming together today. And also want to thank the audience for being here, and we look forward to a good meeting. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. I would just add that if you would like to make an appearance before the board, our appearance forms are in the front, and we'll need you to fill that out if you would just say anything at any time. And if all cell phones could please be silenced. And just general respect overall, we appreciate it throughout the meeting. So with that, we'll move to the Harris Chain of Lakes Restoration Panel. Council? Representative Metz? Do you
want to hear that? Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. This is an issue, members, that I think all of you probably have some familiarity with. The Harris Family Restoration Council, the information in your notebook in Section 3, and it was created by statute around 2001, I believe, somewhere in that range, to develop a restoration plan for the Harris Family Lakes. And so this is a council that is in statute. And there's been a lot of conflict between the council members, who are very good people, by the way. A couple of them that are very prominent and active in the council, I skipped the record, Bob Johnson, and they're very good people and very knowledgeable people. But there's been a lot of conflict over the years between the council and the St. John River Water Management District. And I was trying to tackle that this coming session. That's what I have in the book. There is the enabling statute for the council. There's two statutes there. And what I was trying to do was make it simpler for Lake County water regulation. We have a lot of different entities that are involved. We have the St. John's, of course, as our local water management district. We have the Lake County Water Authority, which is a special district that is unique into itself in the state, that has ad valorem taxing authority and a staff that are very competent about water issues. And then we have the council at the Lake Soil and Water Conservation District. We have all the state agencies as well. And I thought that we could simplify matters. Originally, when I first was elected, and I had a workshop when I was chair of the delegation, which we had about 3 years ago or something like that. We had all the various entities involved come into the delegation meeting like this and present what their roles were. So I just note that the conflicts continue to exist. I've had the St. John's River Water Management District Executive Director visit me in my district office about it. I don't know if you all had such a visit, but I did. And so I was trying to come up with a solution, and I think I rounded with each one of you about it not too long ago. So what I've decided to do, because there's not a, I guess the timing may not be perfect for this issue, I just wanted to give you the work product that I have since I'm going to be leaving the legislature in a year. So it's in the notebook, and I'll just quickly walk you through it. See, it's at tab 3. Actually, it's under section 4. 3 and 4. 3C and 4. The reason why is that what I was trying to do, go to 3 subsection C first. And that is simply a repealer bill of the current statutes that would provide for the Harris Chain of Lakes Restoration Council. And that was based on the idea that we could put the authority for the Harris Chain of Lakes Restoration expressly with the Lake County Water Authority. And I had drafted a local bill to that end, which is in your tab at 4B. And you'll see that was just a draft, but it would take the responsibility for the Harris Chain of Lakes Restoration and put it squarely with the Lake County Water Authority. And the reason for this solution was that I've heard from the council that they don't have authority, that they don't have resources, and that's some of the frustrations that they have. And they were asking for more authority to direct and also resources. And I thought if you're going to, why have another agency that has that type of authority when we have the Water Authority already? So I thought putting the responsibility with the Water Authority made perfect sense and eliminate one of the many cooks in the kitchen, so to speak, for water regulation in Lake County. So that's what I have there for you is the work product. I've decided not to file these for this current session. Since I'll be term limited in a year,
I won't be able to file them next year, beginning 2019, the session will begin after the next election. So I just wanted you to have the benefit of my thoughts on it and provide that to you. And then, as far as the two items that are listed for the agenda, this is all background for you, why I was interested in this issue, but we also had a vacancy on the council. Thought we had someone interested in filling that vacancy, but it turns out that person can't proceed with their service in that regard. So I don't have anybody to recommend, unless you all have somebody that you'd like to recommend for the position that's open. It requires some training as an attorney, but that can be waived on delegation of a meeting like this. So that was one of the reasons that I put it on the agenda. After we have the agenda developed, the person said they couldn't serve. So we don't have anybody to put it on there unless somebody else, I hear, has a recommendation to make. And the second item is the, apply study, and that was something that Senator Baxley and I discussed, because he was, received a letter from the council about that, and that's in your books as well. I thought we'd put it on there just in case we wanted to talk about it today. I don't think it's an action item per se for the delegation, but this is an opportunity. It's in section 3B in your books. The letter from, about the apply study, and that's just, I think all of you got a copy of this at some point, I assume that anyway. I know I did. So Senator Baxley, I just put it there, since we were bringing up the council, if anybody wants to, or maybe you could question change.
You recognize Senator Baxley?
I was wondering if you might, having done quite a bit of research on this arena for an extended period of time, like to outline for us and for those attending the process by which an apply study is enacted. Procedures.
Chair, ma'am.
You recognize.
I've never requested one myself, so I don't know the details of it. I know that it's a legislative study unit, it actually works for the legislature, so you have to be requested by a member and then pushed through the process. The leaders, I think, have the ultimate authority, meaning the presiding officers, to direct that. But there's obviously a financial cost associated with allocating resources to the study, so that would be a determination they'd have to make if they could afford to do that or not. If they're doing it on the DCD, for example.
Yes, Chair, recognize.
Chairman, I have looked at it. The procedures may be somewhat a little bit different on the request through either the Senate or the House. In the Senate, my understanding of what study we've done is the proper procedures for the Senate member to make that request to the president, and then he would actually, at that point, decide, you know, about offering it to the Papaga unit. They are funded to do ongoing research for the legislature on a number of things. And the letter of request was fairly specific. It's been under consideration for a while. I personally haven't reached a decision about how to present that to the president, and may not do so until after session. Right now, we're sort of a blur, and there will be some spending decisions I'm thinking might be more appropriate, not mixed into the milieu of what goes on during session, and be done as an independent study and analyze what we've done in addressing the various chain of lakes and actually all the lakes of our region. And so right now, that's my intent, is not to move on it immediately, but to hold that as a question we might ask to bring some clarity about the success of our spending in different areas on lake restoration, which is a very big and important issue for this delegation, as well as a few more in north central Florida. So I'm still in a conferring basis on that. Unless the delegation feels otherwise, I will probably continue to move in that direction. Let's work through session, and after session, get some clarity about what type of requests we want to make to the president regarding this issue. Thank you.
Representative Metz. You're recognized.
And I certainly hope that you'll be involved in that discussion as a citizen of Wake County who is very well informed and can bring discussion to the table, however we proceed. But I think to try to put that in the mix of session right now might be counterproductive, particularly the funding of lakes and restoration. And we can do some more directive things based on what the outcome of that study is on, you know, actual spending. So for purpose of the general population, the Office of Program and Policy Analysis is simply that a research arm of the legislature to take issues that we need investigated from just a legislative perspective to give us input. And the idea is to have independent analysis that doesn't come with a preconception of whether we've been doing everything right or whether we've been doing everything wrong or whether we can do things better, particularly in cleaning up our lakes and making them usable and functional and protecting our natural resource. At the same time, we're considering the impact on what we do with these great resources as we look to the people we represent. So that's my present standing on it, just to clarify to the other members of the delegation how I'm processing it. To me, I think the proper thing is to hold it in abeyance till we finish session, and then the long view is what I'm looking for. What are the long-term solutions to resolving these different conflicting views of what the right answers are and how to manage these resources? I'm not a hydrologist. I don't pretend that I know all the right answers, but I know there's some conflicting views about what's fruitful and what's not fruitful, and what's urgent and what's not urgent. And I think a third party look, and we don't always just enact whatever OPAGA says. It's generally that. It's a study to tell us from an objective view. Somebody that's not in the middle of any of this has no dog in the hunt. Just look through the whole thing, examine each perspective, and come back with a report and say, here's what we found. And I think that could be clarifying no matter how it comes out. And it may or may not weigh heavily on what's actually done following that, but at least it would be third-party objective research in looking at the whole picture for us to give us better insight on how to proceed. And then we'd have the backing of that study should we find it meaningful and viable information to act on. So that's that process, and I appreciate you bringing it before the delegation today so we can discuss it.
No, thank you very much, Madam Chair. I appreciate the opportunity to be heard on.
All right, before we bring this bullet point to a close, I do have a public hearing appearance in regards to high water levels by Randall Rainey. You're recognized to speak.
Good afternoon, Randall Rainey here. Well, we're on the subject matter of the Water Authority. We all live Irma, watch Irma. Okay, we can't forget about that. And the Water Authority was holding record of water levels during Hurricane Irma, before Irma, and discharged water about 4 or 5 days beforehand and something needs to be done. We don't need to go through this again. It should have been a learning lesson. And I'd like to see the delegation act on this. Something needs to be done, an emergency meeting needs to be held, or legislature or after. And something really needs to be done. This is a very, very serious issue.
Does that conclude your remarks?
No, I was going to ask you guys if you had any response.
Members, are there any questions?
This has been ongoing for two-thirds of the century. Something needs to be done. We can't wait for another year. Back hurting season is not even over.
Thank you, Mr. Randall, for coming and speaking.
Thank you. Take that consideration, please.
Next on our agenda, we have local bill presentation on the South Lake County Hospital District. Representative Metz, you're recognized.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, with your indulgence, I'd like to give a little bit of background information about the issue. This would be a little bit more than we would normally do at a committee meeting in Tallahassee, where it's a structured format for the expedite the ultimate handling decision.
Absolutely, you're recognized.
Thank you. Well, the first thing I want to do is explain the local bill process so that members of the audience understand procedurally what things are with this. General bills are the ones that we filed that would have changed and evolved for the entire state, whereas a local bill would have applied locally only. It's a special act, if you will, or applied only to a local area. So this is a local bill that would only apply to the South Lake County Hospital District area. It's a repeal bill, which would repeal the district, the South Lake County Hospital District. And the bill is fairly self-explanatory, not very long or involved. I want to mention that the way the process works, the legislative delegation has to approve the local bill before the member can file it. That's what we're dealing with here today. It's a green light for the member to file the bill. Once the bill is approved by the delegation and the member files the bill, at any time before noon on the first session, which is January the 9th, then the bill runs through the legislative process like any other bill at that point. The Speaker's office would refer it to one or more committees. There'd be a hearing or hearings on it, and it would make its way to the House floor if the committee's cleared the bill, and then it would go to the floor for a vote. If the House passed the bill, then it would go to the Senate with all the other local bills under a local bill calendar that the Senate would take up on a particular day, probably later in the session rather than earlier, and then the Senate would have a chance to vote on the bills as well. The local bills have to, by definition, provide a rule that, is originated in the House. So today's meeting is not the end of the process, it's the beginning of the process. And I'm proposing the local bill, the delegation to consider, so that I might then file the bill and then let it run through the whole process that I just mentioned. So procedurally, that's where we are. I thought that would be helpful for those in the audience who don't know the difference between the local bill and the general bill. It is a nuance that only legislators and experienced staff members might know about. So now, as far as the actual bill, the bill to repeal the South Lake County Hospital District. I want to give you a little bit of history on the district itself. It was created by a local bill in 1969. It's 48 years ago. And if you think back to that time, I know some of us can actually remember that year. Others might not, but it was 14 years after the Citrus Tower was constructed. It was 2 years before Disney World opened its doors. It was 1 year before the census that showed Lake County's population for the entire county was 69,035 people. That population, by the way, increased to 297,052 people in 2010, and it's estimated now to be 335,000. So this district was created at a time when Lake County was very rural, not very well populated, and other districts like it were created at various times, either before or after that time, but mostly before, to help finance hospitals that were in these struggling areas that might not be able to support a hospital with just the rate of revenue that would come. Also keep in mind these programs that are now very prominent in healthcare finance, Medicare, Medicaid, were very young programs at that point also. So the idea being that some of these districts were created to make sure that a hospital could
establish itself in a local community by guaranteeing a revenue stream for property taxes. And I presume that's the reason that the local delegation in 1969 approved the bill to go forward, and then it was then passed by the legislature and signed by the governor. So we have 48 years of change since then, and we're now at the point where we have a very well-developed economy in South Lake County. It's a lot of people that live here that work in Orlando for companies like Disney and Universal. We have good health benefits. There's a whole different world now compared to when this was created. Now, I am, by admission here, I will confess I'm a limited government conservative. I believe in limited government. I believe in scrutinizing requests to create government or expand government to ensure that they're meeting the fundamental purpose of government. And philosophically, while this district could have been justified 48 years ago, I looked at it very carefully this year, and I wanted to make sure that I was proceeding on solid principled grounds. And I don't see how you can justify in this day and age creating a unit of government, a special interest governmental unit called a special district, that benefits one private tax-exempt hospital corporation with property taxes guaranteed from every property within its boundary. And we all know property taxes are mandatory. They're collected based on the value of the property, and therefore they are progressive. They're taxed on every property in South Lake County for the hospital, whether there's people living there or not. And the money is given to the hospital so that it can provide health care services. Now, I want to make it clear, my decision to run this bill is not about any type of punishment for the hospital because they squandered money or wasted money or anything like that. I think South Lake Hospital is a top-notch operation, one of my top-notch people. John Moore, the CEO, is a fantastic CEO. I have no reason to doubt his competence and his successes there, as well as his team of people that he has working for him. This is not about, well, we have a scandal, we have to solve it by eliminating a district. This is about the principled basis of, is there a reason to have a special district that is serving only one private tax-exempt hospital corporation, providing revenue to that entity so that it can have more profitability? I say more because South Lake Hospital Inc. is a profitable operation. So my bill to repeal it is based on the idea that it's not a proper function of government, and we shouldn't continue to be one of the 12 counties that has taxing districts for hospitals, for private hospitals in Florida. 55 counties do not have such districts, so my bill would help us, at least in the south end of the county, join partially the other counties that do not have them. Our neighboring counties, Senator Baxley represents Marion County and Sumter County, the latter in its entirety. Neither of those counties' residents pay any hospital tax, property tax for hospitals in those two counties. Senator Stargell, who could not be here today, represents a large portion of Polk County. They don't have a hospital district that taxes its residents. So we don't have a taxing district in Orange County. Seminole County does not have one. There are three of them in Volusia County, however. So this is not, something that should continue in Lake County. That's why I'm running the bill. I want to also, before I conclude my presentation, mention that the governance of the South Lake Hospital District, there's a lot of, if you look at the enabling legislation, which is in the book, and you just read that, and apply a comparison model to other governmental entities, there's some problems with how this was set up in the beginning. I, for example, don't like the idea of an unelected board that has an ad valorem taxing authority, and that's what we have here. But that's not the purpose of my bill. Again, I'm going back to the not-for-profit function of government foundation for my bill, not the problems of the district. But the 11 appointed trustees, they were appointed by the governor, and almost all of them were appointed by Governor Scott or reappointed if they were serving prior to his election. I think there's one who's a holdover that has not been appointed or reappointed, but continues to serve because the statute says until you're replacing his name, you can continue to serve, and you do continue to serve. So in your book are minutes of a meeting that was held, meeting of the South Lake Hospital District Board of Trustees, May 23rd, 2017. This is very recent, this year, about 6 months ago. And on the second page of that set of minutes, it's 6B in your book, there's a discussion item, and it says, I'm just going to read it verbatim. Several of the members discussed their recent interviews with Governor Rick Scott for their reappointment to the board. They stated that he was very adamant about eliminating the taxi district and did not spend much time discussing other things. I've spoken with Governor Scott about this district a couple of different times over the last few years, once in 2014 and once in this year, about the district and the issue that we're discussing or that I'm presenting. And it was very clear that those minutes are correct, that he has taken that position with the board members when he's appointed them, and that if they did not concur that the tax should be eliminated, they weren't appointed or reappointed. So I believe that it's very clear that board members have stated that they support eliminating the tax. And if you think about an appointment compared to an election, all of us are elected, so we have constituents that we serve based on an election. If you're only seeking an appointment and it's one person that appoints you and it's the governor, and you're making representations to the governor about what your position is on the job that you're being interviewed for, that's kind of like a campaign promise, if you will. It's not the same exact thing, but I think that the governor's appointments reflect his desire, as the minutes show, that the tax be eliminated, and that's what he's trying to do with his appointment power. So I thought you should know that. And I've had some of the board members tell me they want to end the tax, but the board has never taken any official action to do that. So if you think about the overall situation, repeal of the district, it's not going to happen unless a member comes forward from the delegation and initiates it, a House member. And it's not going to happen, I don't think, by initiative of the board members, at least it hasn't happened so far after Governor Scott's been in office 7 years with that mindset in his appointment process. So my ask today of the delegation is to allow me the opportunity to present this bill to the legislature in the full legislative process that I described in my opening remarks. After the proper public input and debate is occurred, to vote in favor of the bill. That is my presentation, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Metz. Members, are there any questions? Yes, Representative
Metz, will you recognize? Representative Metz, this local bill, if we runs the same path as a general bill, but would not be subject to review by the voters as you described, is that correct?
You're recognized.
Thank you. Yes, this bill would go through the legislative process, but it would not be subject to the voter approval.
I don't know if you know.
You're recognized for another question.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I don't know if you know the answer to this, but you're discussing the South Lake Tax District. We just went through this process in the North Lake Tax District, and it was voted on by the voters who voted to continue the tax for an additional 10 years. Why is the South different than the North in that respect?
You're recognized.
Yes, thank you. Well, it gets back to what I said was my reason for running the bill, which is that it's not a proper function of government. The voters, obviously, direct democracy is something that people like to advocate sometimes, but if the government, if it's not a proper function of the government, to me, we shouldn't be doing it to begin with. It rests with us, the responsibility that is, because it was created by our predecessors in these chairs back in 1969, and we should just, to me, end it.
Do you have any other questions? Yes, sure.
I don't know the full details then of the need, the continuing need for the tax to the residents, but I would think that we need some input. Philosophically, I agree, along with your philosophy. I'm in favor of less taxes and lower regulations and smaller government. However, when it comes down to a specific issue like this, we ought to have some additional background information, like you say the hospital is in John. Is John Moore going to speak today? Does he have a card?
I haven't received it. That doesn't mean that. I mean, he's certainly welcome to.
Okay. over the past numbers of years, it's been a pretty hostile operating environment for healthcare systems in general. And survival was high on their list, and many of them, however high on their list of priorities, did not, in fact, survive. Would the loss of the tax put the profits of South Lake in jeopardy? These are basically rhetorical questions, unless you happen to know the answer. Would that put them in jeopardy, or would the services be diminished? Would the public like to have an input to this decision process that we're undergoing now? Thank you, Madam Chair.
You're welcome. And members, I would just go ahead. I'll let you go ahead. Know the order in which we're going to do this. So we're going to do questions now. We're going to do public input, and then we will have a time to debate. And then I'll let Representative Metz close, and then we'll have a vote, just like committee. That's how I'm going to run it today. So Representative Metz, you're more than welcome if you should choose to respond to any of the hypothetical, or perhaps you have some information. You're welcome to do that. And then Representative Heidfeld, I would just say if you have any other questions, we're happy to take those now, and then also if you'd like to debate later on, you're welcome to do that as well. You're right.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, there is information in your book tab number here, 6C, I believe it is. Yes, some financial information there. I'm not going to go over all of it, it's very detailed, but the total revenue stream of the South Lake Hospital Ames entity in 2016 was $185 million. Its total revenues gained and other support. Patient service revenue was $174,599, so about $10 million less than the total. So the amount of revenue generated by the district representative on field was $5 million a year. So it's a very small percentage of their overall revenue. I didn't do the calculation, but it looks like it's maybe 2.5%, or between 2 and 2.5% of their total revenue stream. So I don't foresee the loss of that revenue creating a dire burden on them. Obviously, they would have to reprioritize their spending in-house and find ways to reduce spending to accommodate the lack of the revenue coming in. But I don't look at that number, the numbers that I just gave you, and look at an emergency situation occurring because of the loss of the revenue. They're doing a very good job of running the hospital. If you look at the balance sheet, which I know is not operations, but that's also indicative of their financial health. There's a statement of income and assets, and they had an increase in their assets from $187 million in 2015 to $203 million in 2016. They're doing a good job, I think, with their financial management, and they would obviously, I think, do a good job figuring out how to adjust to the lack of the tax revenue after the bill passed, assuming it did.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The $5.2 million ad valorem taxes that were income, is that also plussed up by some matching funds from the state that may increase that by an additional two or three times?
Your
Commissioner's one. Thank you, Madam Chair. Yes, there has been in the past been the intergovernmental transfers that allow for additional funds to come in. That has not continued recently, I don't believe, but it hasn't in prior years. I think that's to do with the low-income pool, the LIT program, and there's been some uncertainty about that in the federal government. And more recently, I think it reflects in the statements, the notes to the statements. I recall reading something to the effect that that's no longer, the intergovernmental transfer leveraging is no longer applicable, at least not more recently, in more recent years.
Do you have any other questions? Senator Paxley, you're recognized.
Thank you.
You're recognized for a series of questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chairman, the members' dialogue has stimulated me with some questions. So thank you. First of all, we were looking at the numbers there and having reviewed some of it. Looking at the profitability of a well-run hospital system that's doing a great job, does it still, by your estimates, remain profitable? Should these funds not continue to be passed through a
taxing district.
Madam Chair.
Your amendment.
Thank you, Dr. Wayne, Madam Chair, thank you. I believe it would continue to be profitable, it would not be profitable to the extent of the $5 million that it was not receiving, but obviously there would be decisions made about how to readjust the revenues within the organization to make cuts in spending that would not necessarily be needed.
But it's your observation that the profitability is still there, it would be a profitable operation with or without these pass-through revenues in the taxing district, am I understanding you there?
Well, yeah, Madam Chair, thank you. I'm looking at the operating income for 2016, $10,965,006, so almost $11 million in operating income. So if you take $5 million out of that, you still have $6 million in operating income. That, to me, would be profitable. But the other thing I would mention, Senator Bexley, is that I don't think it's the proper role of government to guarantee the profitability of a private enterprise through having their own taxing authority. So, implicit in your question is it might be, I know you don't necessarily believe that, but I want to make sure I didn't, by my silence, agree to that implicit concept that might be derived from people watching this.
I concur with your observation that it's not a guarantee. We're not here to guarantee every private company's profitability, obviously. The other question I thought of is, in this transition and the district should disappear, and that pass-through not be happening through that channel, would not the Lake County Commission have the same authority to levy this tax and dispense it if that was the will of the people through these county commissioners in lieu of doing it through the taxing district?
Yes, I believe that is true. They would have, under their plenary power, the ability to raise their millage rate if they chose to do that, or cut somewhere else to make up for it, and then funnel revenue in a way that they decided. I do believe that is within their purview. I don't know that they would do that. Obviously, it's hard to predict what five commissioners would do in response to this, but they could do that. And so that case could be made by the hospital if they thought that they could make it to have some type of support provided by the commission, whether it be through a direct payment or a reimbursement model. But yes, that could occur. And if that did occur, that would probably be more accountable than what we have now, because we have an unelected board versus a county commission being elected. And so that would be another consideration there.
Okay. So it's just clarifying to me that if the demand is there of the community's desire that we support with ad valorem taxes on property, that millage could be moved to the county commission's millage, and they could continue to do that should that be the will of the people through the county commissioners. That's what the path I was trying to ascertain. This is not the only source for these income. This money could come still through a different channel. Is that right?
Yes, but they wouldn't be moving the millage cap. The county commission has a general cap of 10 mils under the Constitution, so they still have to operate within that cap.
I got it.
They're not letting anywhere near that right now, so they could accommodate additional millage if they decide to do that. And they could develop a program for reimbursement of energy care or some other type of support model for the hospital if that was necessary.
Thank you.
In my opinion, yes.
That's all I have.
Members, are there any questions before we move to public input? Have we received any more? I'll go ahead and start with Dr. Casey Kesselring. This is in regards to the Southern Hospital District. You're recognized.
Good afternoon. Legislation granting the taxing district was like ours, that it is in a very growing community. And for those of you who were here at South Lake County at that time, know that you know, the hospital existed not far from this building, and in 2000 moved out to its present location, and has since had to serve a very rapidly growing community. So I was looking also at the, I wanted to kind of look for my own benefit, because I was actually one of those board members who met with the governor, who disagreed with the governor's mandate about eliminating the tax delivery. And, you know, profit, we use the word profit and profitability, I think, somewhat incorrectly within the framework of understanding how a nonprofit survives as a business, as an entity. You know, profit is a financial benefit that is realized when the amount of revenue gained from a business activity exceeds the expenses, costs, and taxes needed to sustain the activity. Any profit that is gained goes to the business owners who may or may not decide to spend it on the business. And in a nonprofit world, we don't have that luxury. We have no dividends that we're paying, we have no shareholders that we're paying. Everything that is made in terms of revenue must be reinvested into the business. And that is all within keeping that you are also required to provide services for people who sometimes are unable to pay, or there are a tremendous amount of shortfalls in Medicare expenses as well. But let me get to some more complicated issues. It will be very challenging for the district and Orlando Health, which is a 50% partner, to enter into a process which would dissolve the district. Due to the complexity of this matter, it would have been helpful to discuss this with Representative Metz in advance of today's meeting. We only learned of this on Monday. The legislation proposed would disrupt the district and hospital's current contractual obligations in the governance of South Lake Hospital. The district does not have the ability to change the ownership, structure, or transfer the ownership of South Lake Hospital without consent of Orlando Health. In addition, this legislation could create issues with respect to any outstanding bonds issued by the district. And currently, when we're talking about financials, what we don't hear is the $80 million in debt that we're servicing to be able to provide the services to our community. The process outlined in this bill, in my opinion, is not the most productive approach to meet the healthcare needs of our community from the district's and the hospital's perspective. And if you looked historically at the millage rate since at least 2004, we have been lowering the millage. And I believe that it is our intent, not only because of the governor's desires of this, but our own desires as fiscal keepers of the hospital and the hospital district to continue to work toward lowering the millage rate and perhaps at some point being able to eliminate it. But it would be much more productive for us to enter into a situation where it is not untimely legislated on us. As you may know, the original agreement between Orlando Health and the district was carefully structured by people whose names you will recognize very well because they appear on street signs in the county. Don Whitta, Mike Connolly, George Hovis, and Oakley Seaver. These gentlemen were very, very forward-thinking in this partnership to ensure the long-term growth of quality health care in South Lake County. In attempting to legislate the process, the bill actually harms the negotiating position of the district with Orlando Health. By that, I mean negotiating to ensure services like obstetrics, which for many hospitals, is a losing line of health care. But we want to make sure that those lines and other things that we do at South Lake Hospital continue to be offered in our community, and that the other key services break-even on a good year, but it continues to generate millions in economic impact to Lake County and provides much-needed athletic field and pool access for the community. Although the economic situation is improving in South Lake County, the underinsured patients who need care through the emergency room continues to grow. In addition, the growth of the South Lake County market over the next 2 to 3 years will produce a demand for services in other parts of the district. As the long-range plan for the hospital is considered, the addition of beds, growth of services, and other outpatient services is important to the hospital's mission. The long-range financial plan includes approximately $75 million of spending on expansion and equipment replacement in the upcoming 3 fiscal years. This could be impacted if this legislation goes forward. In Section 1, it says that we are wasting the district's assets.
Doesn't say
that. As a board member who was appointed by the governor and volunteers my personal time, I know how seriously the district takes its responsibility regarding health care investments in our community. As stated before, there is no consideration of the complexities for the partner of the district and the legal agreements and contractual obligations that are involved here. The time frame, likely 6 months, will create a challenge to dissolve the district. There are many complex legal agreements that will need some time to be worked through, revised, and perhaps re-executed. The bill moves all of the outstanding bonds, assets, and liabilities to the Board of County Commissioners of Lake County, but does not place any requirement that the funding be used for health care needs, which was the basis for the millage being collected. I would be remiss if I did not remind you of a few other major items. South Lake Hospital's financial impact to the community in 2015 alone was $229 million, and I know this has grown since then. The hospital has provided $43 million in value back to the community, with $5 million alone in charitable health care in 2016. The hospital is the largest employer in South Lake County with over 1,400 team members and is one of the top 3 employers in Lake County. The hospital has opened the University of Florida Health Cancer Center, Orlando Health at South Lake Hospital, a new radiation oncology center, to give patients in and around Lake County local access to specialized cancer services without having to leave their home. As the former chair of the district, I know how seriously and objectively each member of the district board of trustees takes their responsibilities regarding the public's health care investments in our community. We have not raised the millage since 2004, and have in fact reduced the millage rate 5 times since then. I am very proud to be a part of a district that operates efficiently and serves my community. I am disappointed that we were not contacted in advance of this legislation being filed. We ask respectfully Representative Ness and his delegation to withdraw this legislation. Thank
you. Members, are there any questions? I have a couple questions.
Yes.
First, I just want to commend you and the hospital board for the fact that you guys have reduced the millage rate over 5 times since 2004, I believe is what you said. I commend you for those efforts, and I wish the North Lake Hospital Taxing District would take after your lead in that. A couple questions that I do have. You mentioned that it was recodified in 2001, and I just wanted to know if you know the population numbers between 69 and 2001, kind of what their growth was in South Lake, and the growth between 2001 and 2017, if you have on hand kind of what that
was. I don't personally have that information, but I'm sure we could probably get it.
Okay, and along that lines, the other question I had in regards to that was just the number of homes that have been built since 2001.
So I don't have that information either, but I would say a lot.
Okay, that'd be great. Okay, thank you very much. I appreciate your time coming out. All right, I'm taking these up in the order that they're received, and each home I'll just ask if there are any more, if you could just bring them to me. All right, next we have Commissioner Anthony Sabatini. You're recognized.
Delegation, good afternoon. Good to see everyone. Representative Ness, I just want to commend you once again for your remarkable, remarkable service in the Florida legislature, doing what you're doing even here today. It's been pretty clear that you've been a relentless advocate for common sense, conservative principles in our state and in our community. And today is just another example of him taking on what I consider to be another special interest in our state. We all know what it is that government is supposed to be doing. We know what tax districts are essentially supposed to be doing, and that's focusing on a very simple and pure reason why government exists. I think in the 1950s, as we saw, we learned a lot more about these hospital district taxes in the 1950s, that they existed at a time when it was questionable whether a hospital was going to be able to be profitable and survive the community. And as Representative Sultan's questions just demonstrated just a moment ago, this is one of the most fast-growing and what's going to be in the future one of the most lucrative areas in the country, definitely in the state of Florida. These hospitals are the most powerful and profitable entities in our community. This special taxing district exists in less than, I think, a quarter, maybe a fifth of the hospitals in the state. And to see the hospitals cling on to this taxpayer money as hardly as they do tells me more than I even know about them. I absolutely think we should diminish every hospital district tax in the state of Florida. This is a first principles question. This is a very simple question about why these districts exist. And for me, this one is completely illegitimate. And I commend you once again for just taking on relentlessly every special interest represented. Mass. I think you do such a good job. And I appreciate your time. Thanks.
Members, are there any questions? Next, we have Vance Johnson. You're recognized.
Okay. Vance Johnson, I write the blog fiscalrangers.com. If I lived down here, I would thank you all for driving south to come down here. I don't know why we had a meeting down here, but. I'd like to, I have actually four things that I wanted to cover, but I'll start with the one that you're talking about now, and I don't know if you want me to cover the others later after this discussion. But on this hospital district, I followed the change in the law that was initiated by Representative Metz for the Northlake County Hospital. I mean, videos of it, I attended all the meetings, I attended the Northlake County Hospital District board meetings since then, almost until they renewed the tax and it was kind of moot. But there are two issues about this law that are different. In Northlake County, Representative Metz came up with reforms because there was no requirement that anybody ever could vote on it. They hadn't voted on it in like 15, 20 years at least. And some of the half of the county, North County had not ever been able to vote on that tax. Secondly, there was no oversight requirements, so that they could, as I personally would say, they could spend the money on pink flamingos. Okay, so in this one, Mr. Representative Metz is taking a different approach, but the two issues that caused this in the Northlake County, and I think were appropriate, is one, he got a reform law in place, a local law that said all the voters could vote on it. And they did, they voted on it. And so at least I felt that they had a voice in it and they decided to continue it. Secondly, it put a period of expiration of 15, I think it's 15 years on the laws, 10, okay. was asked, why aren't they voting on this change? Well, they didn't vote on the earlier one, I believe, at all, unless maybe it was back in the 60s. There's the oversight that spells out exactly where they're going to spend that money. Isn't going to be spent on pink flamingos or rebuilding facades, or like in North County, they transferred money, in my belief, to help fund the growth of the hospital up in the villages. And so there's a lot of things that can be used for that money that maybe meet the needs of the board, but maybe not of the citizens. And so can I come back on these other three things after you've had this discussion?
Yes, okay. We'll be more than happy to hear your concerns on the matters. Members, are there any questions? Next, we have James Perino with the Emerald Lakes Co-op on special taxing district. I'm assuming this is specifically as it relates to the South Lake Hospital.
Okay, it's not. I just wanted to make a few comments generally on special taxing districts.
Hold on one moment. Members, then are you good with hearing him since it's in general during this time on taxing districts, or would you prefer him to come back after we've discussed? Okay, we'll go ahead and hear you now since it's on taxing districts.
I'll be very brief. I arrived late, and so I wasn't here to address some of the other issues. But to point out that the Lake County Water Authority is also a special taxing district. And something else to look at as to whether their efforts should be examined with that thought in mind. Mainly, I wanted to be sure to hand you this material that I've generated on their performance. And with that, I'll move it to the microphone. Can I just hand
it to you? Yes, if you'll hand it to... If you'll hand it to one of our aides, and they'll make sure to pass it out to us.
Thank you.
Members, are there any questions? At this time, that's all the public hearing appearance records that I have, but was there anyone else in the audience who wanted to speak on the matter before we go into debate? All right, seeing none, members, we're in debate on the proposal. Is there anyone who would like to speak?
Thank you, Madam Chair. In your closing, Representative Metz, I'd appreciate it if you could address some of those issues that had to do with the structure that may be unique, at least in this taxing district, different from the north, that includes the contractual agreements, perhaps, between South Lake and Orlando Health, and how that may be complicated by the $80 million debt in the bonding services that they pay and so on, in the timing that may be imposed upon them to wrap some of these things up or restructure. If I understood in the way of commentary, the $5 million in charitable services is about equal to their taxing district amount. I would have expected that might be more. Just a comment. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Senator Baxley, you're next.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to say that I share some trepidation and that I'm sitting in Senator Starville's district, and I was looking forward to her lead on some things today as we had this discussion. I'm sorry that she was unable to be here. I know she's represented by staff, and if she sent me any kind of remarks or anything, I would certainly like to have the advantage of those. You can deal with that with her with the chair at the close of my remarks. I would love to have her remarks if she sent me, although she could not attend the meeting today. And again, Senator Stargell is the senior senator from this district. I'm sitting in her district, and I have great respect for her evaluation over time of some of these issues, and would value her input as we move along in a process here. I will tell you that I remember being asked a number of times by Governor Bush when I was in the Florida House, if we weren't already doing it, this way, how would we do it? That is a very frightening question to a lot of people because they've structured everything in the way we do it. But at the same time, it's a question we must ask if we're going to unbind the future. And I'm also reminded of a statement that I've seen that for those that say it can't be done, perhaps they need to get out of the way of those that are doing it. I actually think we're capable of doing a lot more things than we know when parameters shift, and we don't know that till we're there, but there are people doing it. The point is, there's 55 counties. How are they getting by and somehow providing health care in spite of not having special taxing districts for this function? That question does haunt me, and sometimes it's a reflection of transition, the time we're in. While it may have been absolutely extraordinary to come up with an idea how a rural county could acquire hospitalization for its constituents and residents and guests, maybe today something has shifted in the numbers and in our understanding of how that's done. And those can sometimes be hard to shift. I've had paradigm paralysis a few times myself at age 65. But I've also seen that balance of restraint and adventurously looking for better ways to do things produce some good results in the long run. With that in place, too, I would tell you that I generally don't do a lot of prodding around into what I consider to be local issues. We have local officials to work those out. What we have here is an entity that was established by state government, so it falls back to this delegation and state government to consider, is this the best way to be doing this? And so that's why I feel like there's a comfort level in looking at it. I also know that having sat as chairman in the House on a committee that hears all these little bills, and there's sometimes hundreds of them, that there's quite a rigorous rubric applied in that committee by the committee staff. There was a lot of boxes to check as to whether or not a local bill was ready to move forward. And I'm sure with Chairman Clayton and Vice Chair Bonfield, they'll get a good chance to see if this bill, or as amended, measures up to the direction it should move in. Should it be considered by them? And I would suggest that it probably would be referred to them as a local bill. Most members, the way you start a discussion is file a bill, and the discussion commences. 90% of bills die somewhere along the way. 10% of bills pass, and after much rigor. And clearly the House is where this process of discussion begins. We don't have a local bills committee. It comes over from the House. It's been the history and the process for local bills. And he can't file this bill unless we sign off. And I have a tendency to defer to my good friend who's done a lot of research on this at this stage in the process for him to fully develop this discussion by filing a bill and also to Chair Sullivan, who both have much senior service in serving Lake County and looking at these specific issues of Lake County. For those reasons, as at this point today, I would support authorizing from the delegation that we move forward. I don't fear the debate. I feel like good ideas tolerate debate. They get better with debate. There's a lot of things that I filed that didn't come out exactly the way or the year I wanted them to come out. But I have to say, I do believe in that process of discussion and that things can get better. And that bills reach their maturity in that process. I don't know if we're at that point or not. We don't know about going down the road a ways to see how all that plays out. But as of today, I don't see any reason that we would stop the process. And as a delegation member, on my own, without Senator Stargell to lean on, until, unless we find some reason in that process that we would stop.
Before I make some statements in debate and before we proceed, was there anything from Senator Sturgill?
I do know that Senator Sturgill has had a discussion about this issue already. She has talked to people from Orlando Health. She's talked to Senate High Representative Metz. And as far as I know at this point, she's ready to proceed.
Thank you. I will be brief, but I'm more than happy to follow up with people individually after the meeting. I would agree with Representative Metz and his intent that unlike perhaps some other districts, that this legislation is not stemming out of poor leadership or misconduct with the money. And so to that, I want to commend you for your work and your leadership and the steps you have taken to lower the millage rate. For me, this vote is more about intent and a philosophy of government. Looking at, I'm a huge believer in going back to the intent of things. As someone especially that's a little bit younger in this process, I often run up against roadblocks of people saying, well, this is the way we've always done it, this is how we're going to continue to do it. And I ask a lot of questions of why. How can we make things better? How can we serve people better? How can we be more efficient? And what is our role of government? What is the intent of why we do what we do and the way that we go about doing it? And so with that, I think that this gives us the opportunity and perhaps opens the door for Lake County as a whole of looking at other counties that go about a millage rate through the Board of County Commissioners. It's not that I necessarily disagree with tax monies going to help fund indigent care. I think we have a responsibility as a community to help the least of these. And I think that's an important role that we have. But I also believe in most positions within government, in an elected position, being closer to the people than in an appointed position, and there being a little bit more transparency, perhaps, a little bit more accountability, and a little bit more access to people to know what's kind of going on and hold those members accountable. And so again, that doesn't come out of this board, a misconduct that I've seen in any way, shape, or form, but more of a philosophy of government that Representative Metz spoke about, and more of the original intent of this board being created at the time of the population of this area. And so with that, I will end my support today in this bill, but I do have a few more questions, as I asked earlier, and some other follow-up that I'll be doing as well throughout this process. With that, Representative Metz, you're recognized to close.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, members, for your debate and your questions earlier in the process here, and I appreciate the public input as well. I do want to go back and reinforce a few points that were made earlier. I think Mr. Yocum was correct in his read of the draft about the issue of wasting of assets. I think that's the stock language that I actually got from committee staff about the bill. I didn't come up with that particular phrase, but it's apparently been used in prior instances where special districts were eliminated and that was the language that was used, but it was not at all intended to say that they're wasting their assets now. It just would say once the law is passed, there's a directive from the state not to waste assets and to follow the procedures in the bill for dissolution and so forth. So I wanted to make that clear. Addressing Representative Honfeld's questions about the bond finance, the financial statements do not, or actually clearly state that the district itself is not liable for the bonds. It's a pass-through entity for the bonding that occurred. That it's actually the hospital corporation that's responsible, and I think in one instance it's the South Lake Hospital Lincoln and another line of bonds. It was Orlando Health, but the point I'm making, regardless of which it was, it's not the district that's liable to pay those bonds back. And there's a provision, in fact, in the notes to financial statements, it says if the district was to be dissolved, there'd have to be another public entity designated to be the pass-through entity on the bonds. So we do that in the bill by naming the Lake County Board of County Commissioners as the pass-through entity for bonding purposes. But it's also clear that the Lake County Board of County Commissioners would not be liable on those bonds, just like the district itself is not liable. So if there's obviously a need for finessing language to make things clearer, that's what the amendment process is all about. We can certainly do that. As far as the complexity, with Lake County, the Lake County Board of County Commissioners standing into the shoes of the district once it's dissolved, there is a place to go for further winding down of any residual matters that need to be taken care of. It's not like it would be completely cut off. There's a way to receive
So, again, I want to go back to the reason for the bill, and we had a comment from Mr. Yocum about the referendum process in the Lower North Dakota County bill that was passed in 2012. That was 5 years ago that I did that bill, and that bill was reflective of the times that I was in at that particular point with the delegation. And it turns out that the referendum that occurred, there was a large amount of money spent by the hospitals, no surprise perhaps, to persuade the voters about their point of view on that. There was no countervailing campaign. People, I think, had other things to do in a busy election year like 2016, the presidential race on the ballot. And there was no organized effort to advertise or to send direct mail in opposition to the mailers that the hospitals put out. There was quite a few of them that were sent. So although it sounds appealing to have a referendum, it was a lopsided referendum in the end in North Lake. And again, my core principles tell me we don't need this type of district. Transferring money for people using the force of government power through ad valorem taxes to a private tax-exempt hospital corporation. And in this particular district, there's only one corporation that benefits from this tax, which is the South Lake Hospital, Inc. No others can participate, so it's kind of monopolistic also when you think about it. Actually, what we need to do in Florida, in my opinion, is move into more competition in healthcare that will drive costs down and quality up like it does in any other area of the economy. But you're not going to have that type of competition when one hospital in an entire territorial area of Lake County has monopolistic tax support from a district, and they're doing well already financially anyway. So these are all reasons to just question why we're doing it this way. Again, if you go back in time, Lake County was a much different place when this was created. I think the 2001 reenactment would have been an updating of certain issues. I don't really have no recollection of what that bill was about, but obviously it wasn't brought with the intention of questioning the need for the district, which is what my bill does. Again, I think Florida has shown that 55 counties can do without special taxing districts for hospitals. I think Lake County should become the 56th county, personally, but we're only dealing with half of the county here with South Lake Hospital, Inc. And I think we'll find a way to survive. It won't be catastrophic. It seems like every time you mention anything about a hospital taxing district being eliminated or constrained, they bring up obstetrics. You know, that's going to be the thing that might be cut. And I just don't accept that. I don't see that happening. A system that has $185 million in total revenue, losing $5 million, they would actually cut something like that. And that was kind of implied in Dr. Kesselman's comments. I just don't see a competent, high-performing CEO like John Moore being given the legislative mandate that the tax will no longer be provided, and therefore he goes from $185 million to $180 million, that he wouldn't find a way to make things work within that organization and still maintain the quality of service that's being provided. So, again, it goes back to my core principles of limited government, that we shouldn't be creating special interest governmental entities that serve only one private tax-exempt entity with tax revenues collected by the force of government power based on a progressive schedule of valuation so that the hospital can be more profitable or can do more things with the money. And again, I stipulate that they probably have used the money for well-spent items that improve their assets or their operations in some fashion. But I don't accept the argument that because they provided $5 million in charity care, that they should get $5 million in property tax revenue. Remember, they're tax exempt for a reason, and the reason is they're expected to provide community benefit. And when we're saying tax exempt, they don't pay tax on their income, on their property, on their purchases. They are completely tax exempt, and the trade-off for that tax exempt status is community benefit. And so I've never accepted the idea that, well, we're doing $5 million in community benefit or charitable care. I think the $5 million number was charitable care, so stick with that. We should therefore get $5 million in ad valorem revenue. I mean, you're getting tax exempt status, you're expected to do charitable care for that reason. And the other 55 counties that don't have these districts provide charitable care also. And so how do they do it? And if their county commissions are levying additional ad valorem taxes to offset that, at least that would be an accountable system with electoral accountability if people were aware of that. So anyway,
closing, Madam Chair, members, I want to return to the point I made at the very beginning. This is the beginning of the process. There was some disappointment expressed at me that I didn't go and vet the bill before I offered it to you. But I look at this is the first step. If I'm not going to be given approval to file a bill, I'm not going to go out and spend the time working it in the community ahead of that. I would like to know that I could at least file a bill. And so you know, that's the purpose of today's meeting. It begins the legislative process, as Senator Baxley explained. And he's a very familiar, senior member of the legislature, also former chairman of the Local Affairs Committee. He laid it out very well, but there's a lot of process to go through. So the technical issues that might exist with the bill language, that's something we could remedy through the amendment process. And as long as we stick with the original intent of the bill, which is the repeal of the district, then we wouldn't be outside of our mandate under the local bill rules of the House, which require that we not. Once you advertise it and file it, you don't amend it to something completely different at that point. It would not be acceptable. If you stay within the original purview, we can amend it as a delegation, just like we did with the Lake County Water Authority Bill last session. We had a few amendments in session we didn't have to have public hearings on because it was within the original intent of the bill. And I simply brought the amendments to your attention one by one, and they were eventually embedded in full committees that were hearing them, just like the normal process provides for. So none of the concerns about process really apply because we're at the beginning, not the end. So in closing, I would just like to say I'm going to adhere to my core principles with this bill. I believe we should eliminate the South Lake County Hospital District in its entirety and allow South Lake Hospital, Inc. and any other hospital entity that wants to do business in South Lake to be free of the revenue stream that is being provided and to operate on core private enterprise principles. And I think if they do that, they're going to find that they can do just fine without the revenue. Yes, it will be challenging initially, but they'll survive because they have a good leadership team and they know what they're doing. So with that, Madam Chair, I ask for your support and I close. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Metz. Would that move into a vote? Senator Baxley?
Yes.
Representative Clunfeld?
Yes.
Representative Metz?
Yes.
I will be voting for this as well. By our vote, we have passed the bill and given, or rather approved, the bill for Representative Metz to carry and to file in the legislature.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, members.
Next, we'll go ahead and go to public input. We have Van Struppen that will come up first, and I have no other public appearance cards. If there was anyone else that wanted to speak on any other matters before the delegation, you're welcome to go ahead and submit that. You're recognized.
Hi, Van Struppen again. Again, I wanted this meeting on a special.
Pardon me, if you could hit the mic button so there's. You just kind of hit it once. There you go.
Get red. Good, it's a red state, too. My blue state.
All right. This discussion about a special district kind of triggered some other issues that I wanted to just fill you in on to keep in your mind when you get involved in different committees and legislation. One is my continuous issue is that there is lacking accountability over constitutional officers, with sheriff, tax collector, and so forth. As a former internal auditor and anti-corruption guy, I've followed budgets and financial issues in the local government and the county here, going to the county board meetings, going to the school district meetings, some of the city council meetings, as well as the legislation meetings like this. And the sheriff, for instance, has more money, gets more money out of the budget than the county operating funds, the county operations do. And yet, he doesn't have public hearings on his budget. He doesn't have to come up with any kind of a detailed proposed budget that can be analyzed by the public. And then he has refused, and there's never been a performance audit of his operations. And I keep bringing this up everywhere. I just, out of the blue, I got a call this morning from the Florida State Accountability Department and about another issue, and I discussed it with them and forwarded that information to them. But they need to have accountability. They need to have performance audits. They need to have public hearings on their budgets, and not so much for the smaller departments, although I think it's good discipline. But we have towns like Astatula that has a smaller budget, under $1 million than some of these constitutional officers, the smaller ones. And yet they have public hearings, they have detailed budgets, and they don't have performance audits, but they should, because this county doesn't have an inspector general that has that authority. There are some counties that do have an inspector general that has that authority. And we lost our county inspector general to another county that does do that. So that's the first thing, is that there needs to be transparency and oversight on the constitutional officers. Secondly, that CRAs, the Speaker of the House, Corcoran, has brought up the issue of CRAs. I've done research on CRAs. I followed them for probably 5 or 6 years, and there's something like 14, I believe, in this county, including one that is in the Sorrento area that was pushed through by the county board. It's actually not a city. And there's a lot of questions. It takes away about $1 million of tax funds out of the general fund of unincorporated taxpayers, and I'm one of them, and it funnels it out to give to cities. Now, why don't the cities raise the tax or have some process to fund their projects themselves? And then some of these projects, I think, are questionable, and I think that's going to come out. Now, California, several years ago, the problem got so bad with the amount of money that was being siphoning out, and we're a small county. But you get to the bigger counties, and there's hundreds of millions of dollars going out. They need to have, and California shut it down. I think it was about 3 or 4 years ago. They just stopped. The state decreed that they took all that money and it put it, I think, into the general fund, or they shut those down. And I would urge you to support anything to provide oversight and maybe to shut down CRAs. Stop them from being renewed. They get renewed after 20 or 30 years, and then they got another 30 years, and they just keep collecting that money. Same for special districts. And then finally, there is a department that oversees the mobile home parks. And I've done research on this. Some of you may have gotten some information I've sent out on this. And they really allow a lot of things to happen by what I call the 5% unethical mobile home park owners. 95% of them are probably, and I think are probably reputable, and they keep their customers happy. But there's that 5%. I've documented an investigation I have, a guy here that owns 5 mobile home parks in Florida, 4 actually. And also there's been some other people who've done that. And I believe that needs to be, an audit needs to be initiated in the Legislative Audit Committee for the information. To have that group audited, and especially to track down all the complaints that are filed. And from my experience, it seems that a lot of these complaints never get officially filed. They go in by phone, and the lady up there talks them out of it. Because I've talked to people down here, elderly people, some of them in their 70s and 80s, and they have a problem with harassment by the mobile home park owner, elder abuse. You know that this state talks all about elder abuse, but yet they have no rules for landlord abuse of elders. Okay, I've talked specifically to the departments, and so a landlord can be very abusive to a retiree. In the case of mobile homes, what they do is harass them to the point where they just freak out and they move out. They abandon their home. Then the owner of the park walks down to DMV and he gets it turned over to him. He files an abandonment process and he gets it, and then he turns around and he resells it to someone else. Okay, those are the kind of things going on. So I think that department needs to be investigated. And with that, thank you very much for holding this.
Thank you, members. Are there any questions? Senator Baxley, you're recognized.
Hopefully what would be a helpful response. I do sit on the Joint Legislative Audit Committee. And you can petition that Joint Legislative Audit Committee. I think it's the rules on it are like 400 petitions that initiate a audit in some area. There may be a restriction on what areas we can get to, but that might be helpful to you to know that. Thank you.
And as the new chair of that committee, if you send me a letter for that audit, I will look at that and consider putting it on the agenda. All right, members, before we adjourn, are there any closing thoughts? Any closing thoughts? All right, seeing none, I would just remind the audience that our session begins in January. We have one more committee week, which is next week, Monday through Friday. And I think I speak for all of us when I say we are accessible, so please feel free to reach out to us on any of the issues discussed today or issues that may come up in the future. And if you're not on our session, I think email us, please see us, because we'd love to keep you informed. It's an honor to serve you. So with that, Senator Baxley, news from Rice.